I've been requested to go a little bit slower today, so I'll try to do that. So you get to the way to slow me down and ask a question. So let's first of all review what we did yesterday. I realize that we didn't have a lot of time to study last night, so we started with a 2-1 factor of finite index. With it, we form a canonical extension. And this is something we had actually four different ways of seeing it. And they really are inequivalent, because if you change the context, they become inequivalent. The one we preferred was to see it as adding to M the orthogonal projection from M to N. You get from Hilbert space, but in fact it was a percent, an excellent set in to N. Then we iterated this. To obtain an increasing tower of 2-1 factors. And we could, if we wanted, I don't think I'm ever going to actually use this, but it's quite natural to take the limit, and that it becomes a 2-1 factor also in a very simple way, by this standard completion procedure. So what do we do then? I think the next step was we started to look at the algebra generated by the EIs, and we got these relations. Very powerful relations that allow you to actually calculate anything that you want to about the algebra generated by these EIs. And then we focused in on this particular element, which I call P sub n, which is 1 minus E1 sub up to sub n. Alright, so several people have asked me, what's the meaning of this? Okay, I was perhaps a little bit swift going over it. So let me tell you, there's two ways to see it. The best way is the geometric way. So these EIs are projections, orthogonal projections on Hilbert space. Right, so there's these subspaces. Everything's infinite dimensional, so you maybe can't quite see them perfectly, but you have these subspaces, E1, E2, E3, and so on. If you have that, then you can take the linear span of these subspaces. Okay, that gives you another subspace. And if you take its closure, in general it won't be closed. In fact, there's very little chance it'll be closed in infinite dimensions. But you can take its closure and project onto that. That's the supremum. There's a standard notation in sort of predictive geometry stuff. Yes. So what Pn is really 1 minus that, which is the projection onto the orthogonal complement. So if you don't like taking your linear span and close it, just think of the space of all vectors that are orthogonal to all of the images of E's. So this subspace is E1 of H, E2 of H, E3 of H. Projections in subspaces, closed subspaces, is the same thing. Now, fortunately, if you're not familiar with that kind of geometry, there's another way to see this, if you just like straight algebra, and that is to say, this only works because things are finite dimensional. You just take the algebra, so over here, you don't have to include the identity. Or you can just look at words on E1 up to EN that are not empty, and you get an algebra. Okay, it's semi-simple because we're in the star context with positive definite trace, so it's extremely semi-simple with complex numbers, and so therefore it has an identity. Okay, and this thing is the identity of that algebra. So that's two ways to look at it. And since, since this is the identity, you have E1 sub E2 sub EN times EI is equal to EI. Which means that if you have P times EI, you get 0. And this was the property that we already talked about for these or any questions on that? So then we had this nice argument. We figured out what the trace was, 1 minus E1 sub EN from Wenzel's recurrence formula, and we found that there was these polynomials, which I'd like to get up again. First one was 1, second one was 1 minus tau. They're given by a simple second order difference equation, so linear difference equation, so we can easily solve that by standard elementary techniques and get nice closed expressions for these polynomials in terms of Chebyshev polynomials or same thing as quantum integers, but we really want to see them like this because they allowed us to check exactly these positivity conditions and with this very careful analysis of what happened, and we came up with the only allowed values of tau being the first positive zeros of these polynomials, and we drew graphs on them. And we found this was a sequence converging to 1/4. Right. And then finally yesterday we actually constructed these EIs. So in a manifestly positive definite way. So that was important. And the way we construct them was we looked at this tau construction in finite dimensions. So this was finite dimension. This was finite dimensional. Then you can still do this construction at least once. We have a trace on here. But then we saw that if you had any desire to continue this construction, you were forced to choose the... remember we saw in finite dimensions that the finite dimension inclusion specified by some kind of system like this, so therefore a matrix lambda, and you had in order to have any chance of having this property true, this so-called Markov property, you had to choose a trace on this, so there's a Perron Frobenius eigenvector here, and the tau ended up being 1 over the Perron Frobenius eigenvalue. So for a countable family of tau, we've realized such a set. Now, okay. So hopefully all of this will be understandable if you're hungry with questions, right? So I want to first of all just tell you some questions that should have occurred to you, right? So the first one. What happens when tau is smaller than 1/4? So this corresponds to mn bigger than 4. I suppose I should put less than or equal to the... Tau equals 1/4 is nice and special because that's when we can do that symmetric experiment. Exactly. So in fact, there's really no problem when tau is 1/4. So it's really tau bigger than 1/4. Well, also tau is 1/4 is index 4. And we can realize an index 4 subfactor by groups. Index 4 by groups. So that's no problem. Well, you know, we using graphs, we can realize a whole lot of values just by this construction, but there'll only be countably many. So that's a little bit unsatisfying. And in fact, if you look at the graph, you'll find that it's been known for a long time that there is a small gap in between 4 and the next graph value, the next norm squared of a graph. Okay, so the next one, it's sort of clear that the ones less than, the ones less than 4, the ones whose norm squared is less than 4, are given by these ADEs. So you could take the E series, and then you could add one vertex here, and to get E9, well, those of you in the know, the norm square of that is actually equal to 4. This is the extended E8, this E8, E9. But then you could add one more, and the norm has to go up. And that ends up being a little bit bigger than 4, the norm squared. There's nothing in between. You can't, you know, this is pretty obviously the smallest graph that you can do that will give you something bigger than 4. So there's a gap in the graph. So you think, oh my God, there's another gap. We've got as far as 4 with index for subfactors, with this 4 cross group button, and then there's a gap. Dear God, there's, you know, 4 is isolated, and there's another gap, and we've got to do something completely new. Well, the data is saved by the fact that a priori, in fact, historically, before any of this started, there was a construction of subfactors I've been hiding from you. A construction of subfactors of index bigger than 4, any value, any real value. Okay, so let me just quickly tell you what that is. Any real algebraic grand root to 4, I'm going to give you a subfactor. So this one is that you wouldn't, I don't think you would pull out of your hat very quickly. But here it is. It has to do with what's called the fundamental group of a 2-1 factor. So let's meditate a bit on what a 2-1 factor looks like. So when I sort of started to get into knot theory, I got used to drawing pictures very early. It was really nice. You know, 3 minutes. You always have a picture of what you're doing, a nice visual image. So I was challenged to come up with a picture of a 2-1 factor. Okay. And this was my best answer. This is completely filled in blown. So that's about the best visual image I can give you of a 2-1 factor. It's just, you know, this is just supposed to represent this continuous dimensionality. It's all filled in. Sort of round because it's very homogeneous. There's lots of automorphisms and so on. So it's not much use, I'm afraid. But it is use in the following thing. You know, if you have a blob like that, then you can sort of make a smaller blob inside it like that, and that should be a 2-1 factor too. So this is the one operation that you do see in this blob picture. And in fact, that's for real. So if you take a projection, people in here. Then one of the basic operations of 2-1 factors is that this so-called corner subalgebra is also a 2-1 factor. So I call it a corner subalgebra, so let's see why I call it that. If you're in the n by n matrices, then the projection is going to be up to the choice of basis, going to look like that. So if you do P times the n by n matrices times that, what do you get? You get exactly that. You get this corner of the n by n matrix, which is also the k by k matrices, so small k. Everyone happy with that? Okay. You can do the same thing, you get a 2-1 factor. But now, since it's just this sort of massive deli blob, it's quite clear that if you do that in finite dimensions, you know, you start from the k by k matrices, you get n by n, you get smaller n by n matrix. Okay. Well, here you get a smaller 2-1 factor, but there's nothing to stop it being isomorphic to the thing that you started with. Okay. So the question, which is a von Neumann question, is EMP isomorphic as an algebra to N? Since it's infinite dimensional, there's no reason why that couldn't occur. And in fact, you can show, if you do a certain amount of work, which is of course very standard now, that if you take the one example, we have an example with this infinity. Remember, if you had an ICC group, an isograph group, you could construct a 2-1 factor by completing the group algebra. But if you do this and the group is this, then it has a property that this is always true. That's not obvious. I don't think there's any quick proof of it. Well, you could give other models of this for which it looks more plausible. And it could be relatively easy to prove. Anyway, it happens. It happens. So once you've got this, you can do this funny construction, which is you can take the end and produce a subvector in the following way. You can take the corner PMP, and once it's isomorphic to M, for all P, then it's necessarily isomorphic to 1 minus P. This is a non-zero, non-identity projection, so is this. So they have to be isomorphic. You can choose an isomorphism as your free will desires. Okay. You know, it's actually a job to construct one, but they exist. And then you can define the following subfactor, or M. First of all, as it really is, which is the set of all x plus theta of x. Okay. P and 1 minus P are orthogonal, so when you take these things, multiplication happens in each part separately. So separately, but not independently. When you've got x, what you should think of is this picture here. So x theta of x zero. But you know, what's controlling everything is just the x. And once you've got this component, the other one is forced. So in fact, you've got a factor also. It's really just the same as the x's, but you've blown it up somehow to fill in the whole thing. Everywhere. It's a sort of funny construction. But anyway, it certainly is an honest subfactor. And what you can check is, so N, what you can check is that MN equals 1 over the trace of P plus 1 over 1 minus. Then it's a standard inequality. The first thing you learn in electric circuits in parallel, this is the resistance of two resistors in parallel, is that this is greater than or equal to 4. Okay, but by von Neumann continuous dimension, this trace of P can be any number, any real number between 0 and 1. So this gives you all values, all real values from 4 to infinity. All real values from 4 to infinity. So we're in great shape. We now know, from an infinite dimensional construction, just by doing the tau, that we now know that these EIs exist for all tau less than a quarter. And I believe way to do it. No, it's not. There's an easier way. There's a way that does not require infinite dimensionality. It requires traces. So we got this trace. We had to do the problem for the initial construction, but we got it. We got the other one. And there is a way that does not invoke the fundamental group. All right. So where are we? Okay. So I answered one question. So we're still reviewing yesterday. I'm pointing out questions that you should have asked me. And the first one was, what happens when tau is less than a quarter? And I've answered that completely. These things exist. There are subfactors with that index. But, as I said, if you take the norms of the graphs, the norm squares of the graphs, they go up to 4, and then there's a gap of E10. First value. There are no graphs with norm squared in between 4 and the norm squared of E10. So it makes you, gives you pause. It makes you think, well, you know, maybe there's some kind of reflection of that gap in the subfactors. And the answer is the jury is still out on this one. This is sort of the main question in the subfactors where I have to explain a little bit. What you will all agree with is that P here itself, commutative. Yeah. P is in the centralizer of N. And all of this continuous values of the index is coming from the fact that you have this element in the centralizer. So it's sort of a non-irreducible situation. So now I'm telling you, impose a condition. You don't like this, it's too cheap. Impose a condition, trivial centralizer. And all of a sudden you've just destroyed this continuous family. They're all gone. Your flabby construction disappears. Can't do it anymore. Out. So all of a sudden you're back to the situation where you got up to 4. By the way, this condition is automatically followed if the index is less than 4. You got up to 4, and you don't know anything anymore. But you know there's a gap. There's a gap in the norms of matrices. The situation here is rather interesting. In this particular factor, Popper announced in 1988 and published in the conference, in the Congress proceedings in 1990, that there's a gap in the index values of subfactors. Okay. Now, unfortunately, we've never seen proof of this, and none of us has been able to figure out how we did it. So it's sort of an open problem. Although, if you ask Popper, he still stands by the fact that he can prove it. He's too busy doing other things. So there you go. On the other hand, the same Popper had slightly earlier proved that if you let the factor vary, if you there are other factors for which you can get this continuum, bigger than 4, in the irreducible case. This is another one of these mind blowers. You can get the continuum bigger than 4 in the irreducible case, but you have to abandon this nice 2-1 factor. And refining it, he and others managed to show that you could do it in this group LLF infinity. Okay. So you can get this continuous irreducible spectrum in the other 2-1 factors. Apparently, you can't get it in this so-called hyperfinite case, but no one knows how to prove it. So we all believe in Popper, because he never makes mistakes. There's been some doubts that have been expressed, but anyway, I found it extremely hard to believe that you could realize the continuum in this irreducible case at all. And but that's one of the goals of this course. I'm going to give you a construction. It starts with a planar algebra construction, different from the Popper's one, which actually is sort of functorial and natural, and will give us the continuum. start from the temporally deep algebra and get the irreducible one. Okay. So that's the final goal of this lecture, is to do that. And it's a little bit quite simple, actually. Amazingly simple. Alright, so I think that I've answered all the questions that no one asked about values bigger than 4. Anyone have any more questions? You know, that actually opens a whole can of worms, so if you have any more questions about anything bigger than 4, feel free to ask. We'll come back to that. Alright, so what is another question that that everyone should have asked yesterday? Okay. Well, we have studied these inclusions of finite dimensional algebras, right? And we've understood that A contained in B is always given by one of these diagrams. These are called, by the way, they're called Bradley diagrams. After the Norwegian mathematician Ulla Bradley, not an Italian Bradley, it's Ulla, who some of you may know, his father was Prime Minister of Norway. Anyway. So we know that finite inclusions of finite dimensional algebras are given by this diagram. So do we have any finite dimensional algebras that we like hanging around? Well, yes, we do. We have this temporally leap thing. So the other question is, what's the Bradley diagram for temporally leap? And it won't be just one inclusion, because if we call A n, we could call that the algebra generator 1, 1, 2. We have an, obviously, containing an plus 1, containing an plus 2, and so on. So each one of these will have its Bradley diagram, and you'll get some. Well, what will you get? That's the question. So that's the question you should have asked. What's the Bradley diagram for the temporally leap algebra? Okay. Well, you know, if you really have been following these lectures, you would say immediately, but you told us that already. And I did, indeed. I told you what it was in the generic case. That was our conclusion from our very quick construction of all of the irreducible representations of the temporally leap.